Hello, and welcome to part 4 of the TI Precision Lab series on designing low distortion op-amp circuitry. This video focuses on external sources of distortion. Specifically, we will consider how discrete components like resistors and capacitors impact distortion. We will also see how power supply impedance can impact distortion. The first external source of distortion we will discuss is distortion introduced by the power supply. Power supplies can contribute distortion as well as noise. To understand how this happens, let's look at this circuit with a gain of 1. This op amp sources current out of the positive supply into the load resistor for positive half cycles of the sine wave, and it sinks current out of the negative supply during negative half cycles of the sine wave. Power supplies all have some non-zero output impedance, represented in this schematic as RPS plus and RPS minus. This means that as the op-amp sources current from the positive supply to the load, a voltage drop occurs across the output impedance of the power supply. If we measured the voltage at the op-amp positive power supply pin, we would see little dips in the power supply voltage when the op-amp conducts current from the positive supply. Likewise, if we were to look at the op-amp negative supply pin, we would see little humps in the power supply voltage when the op-amp conducts current from the negative supply. The voltage on the op-amp supply pins looks just like a half-wave rectified sine wave. If we perform a Fourier expansion on a half-wave rectified sine wave as shown here, the factor of 2 times n in the cosine function will generate only even harmonics. Note that the even harmonics are attenuated by the power supply rejection of the op-amp, but this is finite, and so some of these harmonics will show up in the output signal. To demonstrate this, let's look at an OPA-172 with a 32-ohm load. The load was intentionally selected to be a low value so that the current the op-amp sources and sinks from the power supplies would be significant. We also added a 3-ohm source impedance to the supply with a switch across it so that the source impedance could be shorted to 0 ohms. That way, we could compare the ideal case where the supply impedance is 0 to the case where the supply impedance is 3 ohms. The FFT result for both cases is shown here, where the 3-ohm case is shown in blue and the 0-ohm case is shown in red. We see that the even harmonics are substantially larger in the case where the source impedance is 3 ohms than in the case where it is 0 ohms. The table lists the specific levels for the even harmonics for the 0-ohm and 3-ohm cases. Continuing with the same circuit, this slide shows the FFT of the supply voltage of the device. As we would expect from the Fourier expansion results for the half-rectified sine wave, the supply has a lot of even harmonic content. As mentioned previously, these harmonics are attenuated by the power supply rejection of the op-amp and then appear at the output as shown here. The most common external source of distortion that engineers face is probably related to ceramic capacitors. Most often, Y5V, X7R, or other high-K dielectric type capacitors are the problem. To demonstrate this, let's compare the results when using the OPA-172 with an X7R feedback capacitor and then a C0G or NP0 feedback capacitor. The C0G capacitor has a low voltage coefficient, whereas the X7R capacitor has a high voltage coefficient. In this circuit, the output signal is 3 volts RMS and the voltage across the capacitor is 2.48 volts RMS. Because the X7R capacitor has a high voltage coefficient, its capacitance changes as the voltage across it changes, and it will therefore draw a nonlinear current. If the voltage across the capacitor is really small, it may not contribute significant distortion, but in this particular location there is a significant voltage across it. Notice that if you compare the blue X7R measured results to the red C0G results, the C0G circuit has substantially less distortion. In fact, the harmonics are at negative 135 dB for the C0G circuit, whereas they're at negative 68 dB for the X7R circuit. Let's look a little closer at the distortion caused by ceramic capacitors. First, the capacitance of class 2 and 3 ceramics will vary greatly with the applied voltage. Examples of these are X7R and Y5V capacitors. The change in capacitance versus applied voltage is called the voltage coefficient of the capacitance, or VCC. This effect is caused by changes in the capacitor dielectric constant with the intensity of an applied electric field. The change in electric field also causes changes to the dimensions of the capacitor. This causes a reverse piezoelectric effect in ceramic capacitors, making the capacitance decrease with applied voltage. In the case of film capacitors, the opposite occurs. That is, the electrostatic force will actually cause the plates to squeeze closer together, which causes an increase in the total capacitance. In either case, the key point is that the change in capacitance will introduce distortion. The top plot was taken from an X7R manufacturer datasheet and shows how X7R capacitance changes as a percentage of the rated voltage. The graph on the bottom shows how the value of a capacitor will change in real time for an applied sine wave. Input AC coupling capacitors can also produce distortion. Many engineers believe that because the input coupling capacitor is so large, that the voltage across it should be low enough that it won't contribute to significant distortion. But this is not the case. The graph on the right shows the THD plus N for several different combinations of input coupling capacitors and input resistors, CN and RN. First, the red curve at the bottom shows the results with the AC coupling capacitor completely shorted. This is the distortion for the system. Next, the blue curve is from a 1 microfarad 6.3 volt rated input coupling capacitor with a 10 kiloohm resistor. The distortion that comes from this combination starts fairly high in frequency at about 2 kHz. Increasing the coupling capacitor value pushes the AC coupling corner lower in frequency and helps to reduce the distortion because the voltage drop across the capacitor is reduced. The green and yellow curves are both for 10 microfarad coupling capacitors with a 10 kiloohm resistor. The difference is that the green curve is for a 50 volt cap and the yellow curve is for a 6.3 volt cap. We did not mix these two curves up, and the 50-volt capacitor actually measured worse than the 6.3-volt capacitor. Ceramic capacitor dielectric types only specify the behavior over temperature, and there isn't a standard that defines the behavior versus applied voltage. So, the voltage coefficient of two capacitors can be drastically different regardless of the voltage rating. Of course, you shouldn't draw the conclusion that the 6.3-volt rated capacitor will always be better, as it's just as likely to be worse in some cases depending on the manufacturer and other factors. Finally, the orange curve at the bottom uses a 10 microfarad coupling capacitor and a 100 kiloohm input resistor. In this case, the input impedance was increased by a factor of 10 to reduce the cutoff frequency. We adjusted the input impedance in this case because a 100 microfarad coupling capacitor may not be practical in some applications. In this case, we see that the distortion is very near the distortion floor. The conclusion is that if we need to use nonlinear input coupling capacitor types, it's best to set the high-pass corner frequency 2 decades below the desired corner frequency. For example, if we want the corner frequency at 20 Hz, we need to set the corner frequency to 0.2 Hz. Surface mount resistors also have a voltage coefficient. This is especially a problem with small package types such as 0201, 0402, and 0603. The problem mainly happens with thick film resistor types. Also, this issue is usually only seen at large signal voltages such as 3 volts RMS and greater. This behavior occurs because with smaller package types, the end caps of the resistor are closer together, and consequently the electric field across the resistor is higher and the resistivity changes as a function of the electric field across it. These two plots compare the same circuit tested with thick film and thin film resistors. Clearly, the thick film resistors significantly increase the distortion. Of course, thin film resistors cost more than thick film resistors, but if you are using an expensive low distortion op amp and you need to use small resistor packages, then they need to be thin film to maintain good performance. Distortion from ESD protection is caused by the same effects that we discussed for op amp input stage distortion. That is, the reverse bias junction capacitance will vary with applied voltage. As the signal applied to the ESD protection diodes changes, their capacitance will change. This causes them to draw a nonlinear current, which is converted to a nonlinear voltage by the source impedance. If we examine the circuit above, there are ESD protection diodes on both the input and the output. The interesting thing is that the input ESD diodes introduce distortion, whereas the output diodes will not. The input ESD diodes draw a nonlinear current through the source impedance, which may be fairly large. The output ESD diodes draw a nonlinear current as well, but because the op amp output impedance is very low, the translation of nonlinear currents to voltage is minimized. So, the general recommendation is to first choose diodes with the lowest junction capacitance possible, and second, place the diodes at low impedance nodes if possible. CMOS switches normally have an NMOS switch and a PMOS switch in parallel, with their sources and drains connected together. The control logic connects directly to the gate of the NMOS switch and is inverted and then connects to the gate of the PMOS switch. As the switch input voltage gets more positive, the voltage drop between the gate and source of the NMOS is decreasing, and the voltage drop between the gate and source of the PMOS is increasing. This has the effect of decreasing the PMOS resistance and increasing the NMOS resistance. The two transistors are in parallel, and so their resistances are in parallel. Combining the two parallel impedances produces the combined on-resistance curve shown in purple. A constant theme in low distortion design is that any time an impedance in the signal path changes with voltage, it will produce distortion. So, switches placed in series with the output load will often produce distortion. This is especially true if the load resistance is low in value. For high impedance loads where the current through the switch is minimal, variations in the switch on resistance may be inconsequential. This op-amp circuit illustrates one possible solution to this problem using two switches. Switch 1 is in the forward pathway, and switch 2 is in the feedback path. The current through switch 2 is essentially zero since it connects to the inverting input of the amplifier. Since no current is flowing through switch 2, it does not introduce any additional distortion. Switch 2 provides feedback from the output node and allows feedback to cancel distortion introduced by switch 1. Resistor R1 provides a feedback path when switch 1 and switch 2 are in the ground position and the amplifier is disconnected from the load. Further details on this circuit's operation are given in Reducing Distortion from CMOS Analog Switches by John Caldwell, published in the first quarter 2015 Analog Application Journal. In summary, there are several guidelines for reducing distortion from external sources. First, minimize the distortion from power supplies by choosing amplifiers that have high power supply rejection ratio in the desired signal passband. Also, use large bulk decoupling capacitors near the voltage regulator output to decrease the AC impedance, and also try to minimize the PCB trace length. Use low distortion C0G, NP0, or polypropylene film capacitors in the signal path. For AC coupling capacitors, place the corner frequency greater than 2 decades below the signal passband. Use thin film surface mount resistors when small package sizes are required. If larger package sizes such as 1206 are possible, then thick film resistors are also okay. For the absolute best results, use through-hole metal film resistors. When adding external ESD protection, select the protection devices with the lowest junction capacitance available. Also, place the ESD protection at low impedance nodes to minimize the distortion contribution. Finally, in the case of CMOS switches, minimize the current through the switch by using them with high impedance loads. Another option is to close the switch inside the feedback loop of the amplifier, allowing feedback to minimize distortion. In summary, we explain the external sources of distortion in op-amp circuitry. We also learn methods for minimizing this distortion. This concludes the series on designing low distortion op-amp circuitry. Thank you for your time. Please try the quiz to check your understanding of this video's content.